Hello, everyone. This is Professor Hamamoto. The date is September 11, year 2021, 11:50 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. In preparation for the 20th anniversary of 9/11 year 2001, when America and the world was forever changed, I turned to one of the more prominent figures in American letters, namely Thomas Pynchon. I turned to one of his more recent novels, titled Bleeding Edge, published in 2014, to learn his insights about the events of 9/11/2001. I'll have a comment or two at the end of this short reading, but I'm more interested in your perceptions, so please leave a comment below if you like. Thank you once again, ladies and gentlemen, for joining me today. Bleeding Edge by Thomas Pynchon, 2014, Chapter 30. If you read nothing but the newspaper of record, you might believe that New York City, like the nation, united in sorrow and shock, has risen to the challenge of global jihadism, joining a righteous crusade Bush's people are now calling the War on Terror. If you go to other sources, the internet, for example, you might get a different picture. Out in the vast, undefined anarchism of cyberspace, among the billions of self-resonant fantasies, dark possibilities are beginning to emerge. The plume of smoke and finely divided structural and human debris has been blowing southwest toward Bayonne and Staten Island, but you can smell it all the way uptown. A bitter chemical smell of death and burning that no one in memory has ever in this city smelled before, and which lingers for weeks. Though everyone south of 14th Street has been directly touched one way or another, for much of the city the experience has come to them mediated, mostly by television. The farther uptown, the more secondhand the moment. Stories from family members commuting to work, friends, friends of friends, phone conversations, hearsay, folklore. As forces in whose interests it compellingly lies to seize control of the narrative as quickly as possible come into play, and dependable history shrinks to a dismal perimeter centered on Ground Zero, a Cold War term taken from the scenarios of nuclear war so popular in the early 60s. This was nowhere near a Soviet nuclear strike on downtown Manhattan, yet those who repeat Ground Zero over and over do so without shame or concern for etymology. The purpose is to get people cranked up in a certain way, cranked up, scared, and helpless. For a couple of days, the West Side Highway falls silent. People between Riverside and West End miss the ambient racket and don't get to sleep so easily. On Broadway, meanwhile, it's different. Flatbeds carrying hydraulic cranes and track loaders and other heavy equipment go thundering downtown in convoys day and night. Fighter planes roar overhead. Helicopters hang battering the air for hours close above the rooftops. Sirens are a constant 24/7. Every firehouse in the city lost somebody on 11 September, and every day people in the neighborhoods leave flowers and home-cooked meals out in front of each one. Corporate ex-tenants of the Trade Center hold elaborate memorial services for those who didn't make it out in time, featuring bagpipers and Marine honor guards. Child choirs from churches and schools around town are booked weeks in advance for solemn performances at Ground Zero, with America the Beautiful and Amazing Grace being musical boilerplate at these events. The atrocity site, which one would have expected to become sacred, or at least inspire a little respect, swiftly becomes occasion instead for open-ended sagas of wheeling and dealing, bickering and bad-mouthing over its future use as real estate, all dutifully celebrated as news in the newspaper of record. Some notice a strange underground rumbling from the direction of Woodlawn Cemetery in the Bronx, which is eventually identified as Robert Moses spinning in his grave. After maybe a day and a half of stunned suspension, the usual ethnic toxicities, fierce as ever, have resumed, Hey, it's New York. American flags appear everywhere, in apartment building lobbies and up in apartment windows, on rooftops, in storefronts and corner groceries, in eateries, on delivery trucks and hot dog stands, on motorcycles and bikes, on cabs driven by members of the Muslim faith who between shifts are taking courses in Spanish as a second language with a view to posing as a slightly less disrespected minority. Though whenever Latino people try putting out some variation like the Puerto Rican flag, they are reflexively cursed and denounced as enemies of America. That terrible morning, so it was later alleged, for a radius of many blocks surrounding the towers, every pushcart disappeared, as if the population of pushcart owners, at the time believed to be most of them Muslim, had been warned to keep away through some network, some evil secret rug rider network, possibly in place for years. The pushcarts stayed away, and so the morning began that much less comfortably, obliging folks to go to work without their customary coffees, danishes, donuts, bottles of water, so many bleak appoggiaturas for what was about to happen. Beliefs like this take hold of the civic imagination. Corner news agents are raided and Islamic-looking suspects hauled away by the busload. Sizable mobile police command centers appear at various flashpoints, especially over on the east side. Whenever, for example, a high-income synagogue or some Arab embassy happens to occupy the same block, and eventually these installations grow not so mobile, becoming with time a permanent part of the cityscape, all but welded to the pavement. Likewise, ships with no visible flags, pretending to be cargo vessels, though with more antennas on them than booms, appear out in the Hudson, drop the hook, and become, effectively, private islands belonging to unnamed security agencies and surrounded by stay-away zones. Roadblocks keep appearing and disappearing along the avenues leading to and away from the major bridges and tunnels. Young guards folk, including clean new camo fatigues and carrying weapons and ammunition clips, are patrolling Penn Station and Grand Central and the Port of Authority. Public holidays and anniversaries become occasions for anxiety. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the reading from Bleeding Edge by Thomas Pynchon. As I promised at the outset, I have a comment or two, and I'll leave it at that. Overall, I was quite disappointed by this excerpt. I thought Thomas Pynchon would come up with something less essayistic. It seems like it's written by someone else, either that or he cribbed it from The New Yorker, The Washington Post, or his reviled paper of record, which he mentions a couple times in the passage. That part was good. But of course, it's the New York Times, and skewering the New York Times is not the most original literary approach, so far as I'm concerned. For a piece of fiction, a literary novel that was published not that long ago in 2014, I would have expected more from the author of V and Gravity's Rainbow, and even Inherent Vice. But what I read was just a tepid, liberal, warmed-over screed about prejudice in the immediate aftermath of 9/11. Ironically, something that you'd read in the op-ed section of the New York Times or any other daily metropolitan American newspaper. I'll leave it at that, ladies and gentlemen. I'll just state that I'm not very much interested in Thomas Pynchon anymore. I find a great deal more information, insight, strangely enough, coming from pop novelists. People like V.C. Andrews, for example. Maybe I'll have more to say later, but for now, thanks again for listening. This is Professor Hamamoto with Cultural Forensics, and I will be back with you soon.